Welcome to the West End Video Newsletter. Tonight we have with us Phil and Frank Privitera, and both of them are attorneys. They're with different law firms. They have volunteered to help us out on our case. As a lot of you know and a lot of you don't, we have gone through the federal courts fighting for our preference, and we've been turned down. Our partners refused because they said we sued them to go through with our participation agreement and go through with all the perks we were supposed to get. So they just cut them out, and they left us high and dry. Now, Frank and Phil are both D.C. Law School graduates. They come from a prominent West End family. Frank Privitera is their father, who is a philanthropist and real estate magnate here in Somerville and in the area. You have your own law firm, and you work for
Lowney & Howard, which is a civil litigation firm, and Robert George & Associates, which is a criminal litigation firm. It's on Newbury Street in Boston.
And they have a pretty good reputation, from what I understand.
Thank you.
You do your own work.
Yeah,
I had a lot of ease with this.
I'm practicing right here on Winter Hill on Broadway in Somerville. All civil, doing a lot of real estate, estate planning, and small business litigation, which kind of brings us into the realm of assisting OWAC with the issues that we're going to discuss here today.
Yeah, would you like to say anything else?
Yeah, Jimmy. I think what we wanted to talk about, Phil and I, today is just kind of give a brief overview of some of the issues that we're looking at to try to assist OWAC, the old West End Housing Corporation.
And we need it.
And that's why we're here. As you've mentioned, I'm sure many people are familiar with, the participation agreement, which was signed between OWAC and Lowell Square Associates, which is a partnership of Keene Development and the Urban Planning Office, part of the Archdiocese, is the subject of dispute between these two parties, Lowell Square and OWAC on the other side. And in that particular agreement, OWAC was promised numerous items, a visitor center, archives, some office space, and the building in West End Place, which has actually been completed, and everyone's seen. It's on Causeway Street at the end where the Chip O'Neill building has been completed. And there's some commercial space that OWAC is entitled to under the agreement. In addition, OWAC was supposed to get some seed money and some other funding money, some technical assistance, and some other expertise assistance that Lowell Square Associates was supposed to help, given their experience with development and that type of thing. And this participation agreement, which spells all that out, is the subject of a dispute currently between OWAC and Lowell Square Associates. At this point in time, we're asking, and they're giving us reasons why that they don't feel they have to provide. Did you want me to talk a little bit about what we've done preliminarily?
Sure, go ahead.
Okay. What we've done thus far is forwarded a demand letter, in accordance with Chapter 92A, and that's the Massachusetts statute which speaks to consumer complaints. It's the pre-litigation mechanism. It's the beginning of a formal demand in accordance with the consumer law. And we have done that on behalf of OWAC to the two partners which make up Lowell Square Associates, Keene and the Archdiocese, and which in this letter, this 93A letter, we've made our formal demand. And they have formally responded under Chapter 93A. And at this point in time, I think what we're doing now is scoping out the possibilities of the reasons they've offered for not providing the things they're supposed to provide under the agreement, to see what validity they have. We're reviewing the facts and things that have happened in the past, and we're exploring the possibility of sitting down with these folks to reach an agreement, which we would very much like to do, and possibly filing a lawsuit to enforce what we're looking for.
And it's a great drive, Jimmy.
Oh, yeah.
culturally and ethnically diverse area of Boston, in which unfortunately numerous families and numerous people sacrificed the lives that they knew. The land was taken by eminent domain for the purposes of urban renewal, and these people, in essence, sacrifice their livelihoods for the betterment of our city and our state and our commonwealth. And in turn, in this final building, this what's called Area E, the old West End place that we're talking about, that building just by the Fleet Center, was a final opportunity for people to return to their homeland. And we're given a number of promises in this participation agreement. And our hopes are that we can enable the clauses in that participation agreement to be enforced and to be honored. These people deserve it.
Yeah, and you know, I think everybody thinks, okay, that because there was so much publicity before this, that we ended up with all these perks that were put forward in the paper. So everybody thinks, because it's sort of like choir league was taken away from us, everybody thinks that this is all over, that the West End is, you know, it's finally put to bed. It isn't. We're still here. We're still fighting for our rights. It seems every time we take one step forward, we have to take two steps back. And it just seems to go on and on. And I know you two, because your sons of West End, just like my kids, have this etched in your brain because the parents bring it down into the kids. I know sometimes you guys, right, get tired of hearing about it.
I mean, that does raise the point that, you know, this case is just, it's not all about, it's not just a contract claim, because the people behind the contract, OWAC and the people who make up OWAC, not just the board of directors, but anybody they represent, kind of have a zealous passion to get the things they were promised in the contract. And that passion kind of derives not just from this particular sequence of negotiations for this contract. It runs from like 40 years of history. The passion drives through.
You got to remember, Jimmy, in the first section of the first area that was developed, what we know now is, for the most part, South River Park.
Right.
This development included units and housing, which was much too expensive, far too expensive for the people who were displaced. They couldn't afford those units.
Well, a lot
stated. That's what makes this final area, this Area E, the old West End place, and the promise is made. That's why it makes it so much more important. But this is the last opportunity. Once this building...
It's strange because our partners, and one of the, and when they were fighting, when the city was fighting Rappaport in court over this last parcel, went into court as a friend of the court, okay, and said that they weren't going to have anything to do with this project. They were just, you know, siding with the city and their lawyers, tell everybody what a morally bankrupt thing South River Park was, and that, you know, West Indies should be allowed to come in. And then we ended up with them as partners. So it was like this sort of incestuous stuff that, you know, first in court, you know, when they're fighting Rapport, saying, well, we're really not going to get involved in this, and the next thing we know, we're their partners. So, and they weren't good partners. Get into that in the second half of this show. But so what do you think about any of the prior stuff that went on, or whatever you think about this suit?
Well, Jimmy, I really don't think it should affect what's going on now. We're trying to make sure the promises that were made in the participation agreement between the developer, which was King Development, the Urban Affairs, the Archdiocese, which includes Father Groden, and the Old West End
Housing
Corporation. We're just here to make sure that those promises are honored.
Right.
These people deserve it. And any prior litigation, at least in my reading and perhaps in Frank's reading of the law and the federal decisions, have no bearing on it. This contract and its validity was not litigated. The contract was not litigated. It was a completely separate issue, which decided preference and the reading of a statute.
Exactly.
And it wasn't. It was not a clear statute, and that's why litigation was required. And it went all the way to a federal circuit court of appeal, and even the three judges on the board
court
could not agree.
Right.
You know,
we had one dissent.
It was 2-1. I mean, you know, it just goes to show that, you know, it was an issue that had to be decided by the court. Whose reading of the statute was correct? And preference was only just one clause in a contract, a participation agreement with the old West Enders, which is now decided. Now it's time to just enforce the rest of the clauses. There's you know, there's money that's owed to the Old Western Corporation. There is the development of the museum.
Oh yeah.
The property that's owed to the Old Western Corporation for office space.
Mm-hmm.
There is also preference in terms of jobs to Old Westenders in that building who are qualified to do these jobs,
mm-hmm.
maintenance,
mm-hmm.
management.
They're supposed to do that for the construction too, and it never happened.
I mean, I think it's fair to say, you know, that the prior, luckily, the prior case, which is, you know, has been, was decided against OWAC at the court, at the appellate court level, and mm-hmm. the Supreme Court, the U.S. Supreme Court, decided not to hear the case. Luckily, this case, which, again, denied Westenders the ability to come back home into affordable housing, or at least a preference to come back home, did not decide all the issues. That's the good part. So while it's bad, luckily, the contract and the many things that we're seeking to get in the contract was not decided. So a big loss as far as perhaps preference goes, but again, as Phil had already stated, you know, these issues weren't decided, and luckily they weren't. And I think the important thing is that the fact that they weren't, we'd like to get into a dialogue and finish this done. And that dialogue may involve a court case, and we're not sure.
Yeah, well, you know, however it works out, I would just like to get it over with. I mean, I would like to do it, we could do it either easily, or we could do it, you know,
mm-hmm.
the other way. I mean, the other way is just, you know, I've been through too much of it. I would just as soon sit back and relax and take it easy and do it.
I think honoring this enforcement of this contract is a win-win situation for everybody.
Right.
You know, it's just going to help so many good people, so many different people, so many diverse people. It was a close-knit but very diverse community,
mm-hmm.
which is such a great thing. And to help those people, and just to bring it all together, I think is a great thing. It's a win-win situation for all parties involved. Everybody will
be happy.
You know,
Jimmy, you know, and my brother brings up a good point. You know what I'm confused about is that, you know, now that the stage that we're at, where the building is built, and there are 187 units, I think, and all but 20 are occupied.
Right.
You know, and they've sold the shares in the cooperative at some good cost.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, to some good prices. I mean, I'm confused why Lowell Square Associates isn't interested in sitting down with us tomorrow, and saying, hey, you know, there's a bunch of other things in there. You know, let's finish this and let's get in there. I mean. I think it's pretty plain and simple that, you know, the contract provided for a lot of things. One thing was required to go to appellate court, a divided appellate court, to decide one clause. And what about the other, I don't know, 15, 20 clauses? And I'm just confused why these people don't want to sit down.
Well, I'll get into in the second half of this show some of the other stuff. At this point, we're going to go to a take that we did a show about 2 years ago, and we invited Father Groden and Bob Keane on the show. They never showed up, so we put their names on cheers. So, Joe, anytime you're ready, roll tape.
You know, it's a shame.
Actually, you guys should have had some work from there. That's one of the things they agreed to.
No Westenders got a job.
Right.
I was born and brought there. No one ever asked me anything. You know,
they also were supposed to give jobs to Westenders, tile people and everybody that they were supposed to. They didn't do any of that.
No.
They reneged on everything that they said they were going to do. They totally reneged.
They
sounds like Charles River Park again.
They took their airplane.
That's
it's
right.
Like everything. The politicians took their airplane.
Only this time, we have a TV show, okay?
Yes.
And we also have a newspaper this time. It's not going to get buried. The last time when Charles River Park and Rappaport and that crowd did it, it got buried. It's not going to get buried. We're letting the world know, okay? But this is what I want everybody to. This is what Father Groden. He lost a project he was supposed to go to in East Boston. He was supposed to do a project for East Boston. He put the proposal in front of the neighborhood, and they all turned him down flat. And he wrote this letter. I'll read the last paragraph for you. It said, "We are." He's a little bit bitter through the letter. He says, "We are known for building affordable housing. In reality, we build mixed income housing. East Boston wants upper end buyers. Ironically, we are more successful than most in attracting upper-end buyers because we are able, in every case, to offer high-quality, full amenities, and a good investment. Better for less sales at economic levels, but especially at the top. I had looked forward to doing for East Boston what we have been able to do for so many communities. I regret that we will not be doing it." Now, I want to say one thing. When he went over to East Boston, he used the West End as an example of how he got along with the neighborhood and what a great building he built. On the other hand, the East Boston Chamber of Commerce wrote a letter saying, "Yeah, I appreciate that everything you've done, it's fine and everything," and they closed it this way. It says, "In closing," this is from the East Boston Chamber of Commerce,
In your closing, you stated you had looked forward to doing for East Boston what the Archdiocese has been able to do for so many other communities. You expressed your regret that you would not be doing it. And this part is crucial. Please understand East Boston's release that you will not be doing it either. In other words, we know what you did in other places. We're happy that it's not happening here. Okay? I just want that to be said. I have a few questions for Father Michael Groden, Director of Planning Urban Affairs. He didn't want to show up here. I guess he was too busy. He didn't have his answers. one of the promises was when we first were designated to be with them, we were a different outfit called H&D Development. H&D had signed a contract with us. And they were going to give us $500,000 a year and $200,000 a year. $500,000 a year seed money and $200,000 a year for a budget. So that we could start our CDC and get going and incorporate. We had social programs. We had all these things. Father Groden, I want to know why you didn't adhere to this. You said that you would do at least as good for us as H&D would, but you said you couldn't sign a contract with us at that time because you had to wait till it was over. Could you answer us why you wouldn't sign back in 1988 a contract with us when we already had signed a contract with the other outfit? Could you answer that? Oh,
I don't know why Father Groden didn't show up. I believe, I'm just mad, you know.
Yeah.
They had the warning, they were invited, and at the last minute they backed out, they reneged. Yeah. That's not right. And that's how the politicians work. Like, I give an example. You have the West End alone. Now, the summer tunnel, the first summer tunnel, I bought the sticker for $1. It's supposed to be for life.
Mm-hmm.
And the politicians broke their promise again. I put it on my car, and I asked them, why stick it on the window? I like to keep it. Oh, anytime you need a new one, just come up and get it. And this is the deal how the politicians do.
Yeah.
All right? Now they try to push the West End. They try to take Charlestown. And, no, I'm so mad. These high-rise they put in, it breeds only roaches, those big monsters. They're not. You know, you go through and you smell everybody's food and everything. And when I seen this one here, I thought it was a little smaller. It's nice. It'd be a family deal. And that's why I wanted to get into this one twice, you know?
Right.
But when I seen the workmanship inside, I was disappointed, really disappointed.
Let me explain a little bit what happened to me. There's a little story. I applied for one of the apartments. I put in, I was a high number in the lottery, but I was in the market value. I can't afford a lot, so I figured, you know, I'd be a struggle, but I'd be back in the West End, and, you know, and back to the heartland. I was going to get an apartment and do whatever I had to do. I went down to West End Place. They called me up. I gave them all my paperwork and everything. They went through all the paperwork, and I haven't heard them. I haven't heard from them in a long time. All of a sudden, I get a call from Frank Privitera. He says, you know, I'm going down to check the apartments. They told me to call you up and bring you with me. I said, why do they want me? He says, I don't know. They just said to bring you with me. When I get down there, I find out that they have lost all my paperwork. And they said that you still want the apartment. I said, well, I'd like to. I said, but, you know. He said, well, you got to do it by tonight or the apartment goes up by $10,000. It was $109,000. If you don't do it by tonight, it'll go up.
Why did the price go up?
No, I have no idea. Don't ask me.
What is it?
Tonight it's going up
$10,000. We have a storm or something?
I said, well, I can't do anything because my wife is going away on vacation. This was 3 weeks ago. They turned around and he says, well, you either do it tonight or you... I said, well, my wife's gone for 3 weeks. She's going to California. I said, I can't do it. I just can't do it. It's impossible at the time. He says, well... Today I get a registered certified letter. I have it here. If you give me a second, I had it right out front.
Yeah, I forgot mine.
I had a registered letter. And what it says because, now this was 2 weeks ago I was here that they asked me to get this place. And it says,
they try to push it.
It says, because you have not shown any interest in the apartment, we are taking your name off the list.
They did the same thing to me.
And I don't know how 3 weeks can make a difference. Especially, I'm supposed to, I've been instrumental in this building. Yeah. What they're trying to do is keep West Enders out of it. They're using any excuse. Any excuse is enough to kick a West Ender out of there. Because if they can keep the occupancy rate under 50%, West Enders cannot, if there was over 50% of West Enders in that building, they would probably vote the way we wanted them to vote. And the contracts would go. You wouldn't have the same people running the building, management. You wouldn't have all the service contracts that would be different. But if they can keep us down at 30%, they control the building, okay? And that's what they're doing. There's any excuse. There's a guy who could have a misdemeanor record. They forced him out. They said he can't have the apartment because his son had a misdemeanor record. I mean, what the hell is going on down there? These people are, we are being jobbed big time. And I want to say this, anybody, and I mean anybody, that is doing anything with the Planning Office of Urban Affairs, better get it down in writing and better hire a lawyer right at the beginning. And don't listen to Father Groden or look at his collar, because he ducks behind collars and he slim slams neighborhoods behind his collar. I mean, this is what he did to us. You can have input into everything. And they come up with these junky, I cannot tell you how you hit these things and they vibrate. They reverberate. They boom. I mean, the bathtubs are not great.
It says, to the editor, the December 31st letter, a distorted view of Monsignor Groden that claimed Monsignor Groden was misrepresented, defined Groden as a priest but left out his career as a developer. The article the writer was objecting to did just that. It addressed his shortcomings as a developer. Just because a priest does good work in a non-secular area does not forgive outrageous or greedy behavior in a secular role. Is Groden an outstanding priest? I don't know. Is he a good developer? Emphatically no. As a developer, he is at least evasive and forgetful about what he promises, and he has a reluctance to put anything in writing. He is as good at getting the edge as any developer, including Jerome Rappaport, with whom he has dealt in the past. He has trappings of a successful developer, not a monk. He drives a BMW and owns an expensive house in Scituate. They belie his non-secular virtues. He cultivates friendships with celebrities, power merchants, and politicians, and is quick to help them out or make use of them. On the other hand, he is not quite so friendly or accessible to his associates. His associates always seem to end up on the wrong side of a fair break, and if you have a disagreement with him, he is not at all priest-like. He does not turn his cheek or forgive, but takes punitive actions more like a tyrant than a priest. If I had to start my negotiations with Groden all over again, I would have pulled out of the deal and refused to negotiate with him like other neighborhoods have done in the past. This is a letter I sent to the Boston Globe 3 days ago. Sometimes they print these letters, sometimes they don't. But if they don't print it, you can read it on your screen, what I have there. Like I say, Father Groden was found guilty of at least misrepresenting himself and his association and his office, the Office of Urban Planning, to a developer, and the developer lost his option, the developer was awarded $3.5 million for what Father Groden did. Father Groden also has to pay, I think it's $400,000 out of his pocket personally, so mm-hmm. It's not just the Office of Urban Planning that's paying, he has to pay too. He is going to appeal it, but so much for that.
It is kind of ironic that case came out, Jim. It was just recently decided.
Mm-hmm.
For two reasons. One, it's quite similar to ours,
right,
where the Office of Urban Planning is found, I mean, the judge went, it was really harsh, it's an mm-hmm. unfair, immoral, unscrupulous act. And then in addition to that, finding Father Groden personally liable
right.
for an excess of $400,000
right.
is, it does lend some support. It's kind of ironic.
Well, it's very hard when you're talking to a priest and he says, trust me, to say, no, put it in writing. Because how can you hold a priest, you know, he looks at you with a cherub angel at face, and he says, you know, you'll do as well with us as you would with anybody else. And he doesn't want to put anything in writing, so it happens. It happened with this developer. This developer
yeah.
had an option on the property. He says, don't take the option. Let it stay. He says, we'll get federal money and we'll develop it together. Well, the option ran out. He picked it up in the federal distress court. Was it IRE? What do they call that?
It wasn't FDIC. It was the other division.
Okay.
Right. They ended up purchasing it.
Right. He picked it up, and that was the guy lost his option, and he lost money. And the judge said that Groden was being dishonest in this case.
I know it's kind of ironic because it sounds different fact pattern, but similar to ours.
Mm-hmm.
You know, urban development, City of Boston, Urban Office of Urban Planning.
Mm-hmm.
Etc. Same type of thing. Similar. It's kind of ironic. And it's stuff you kind of don't want to believe, to be honest with you.
Mm-hmm.
You don't want
to. No,
you don't
no,
wanna
who wants
it.
To believe that a priest is like that? Nobody does.
Yeah.
So?
Well, Jimmy, I think now is the time then to stick with our focus.
Mm-hmm.
The concerns of the people of the Old West End, you know, a very diverse community.
Exactly.
And people who are deserving the promises that were given to them. And let's try to bring these parties to the table. Mm-hmm. I don't think it's a question of can it be litigated. I come from, I work right now as counsel for two highly powerful litigation firms, Lowney & Howard and Robert George & Associates, my brother's from a litigation firm.
Right.
That's not a question. I think the time is right now to bring the parties together. Let's do what's right. It'd be a win-win situation for everybody involved. I think the people of this city will be able to appreciate what has become new history.
Mm-hmm.
A historic-looking building in a historic area. Let's allow the people who actually live there and made it a historic area live there and be a piece of it. Let's get the title to that museum so that they can contribute to it, make it a great museum, and let's get the title to that office space so that we can continue to follow and spread the ways of the Old West End and the traditions. Let's get those things. Let's work together. Let's make it a great building.
I agree with you, and I try to work with them for a long time, and if we can do it again, I will. Okay, but I'm also a fighter, and if they decide that they don't want to do this and they can continue their ways, sometime in the spring we'll go on our campaign, okay? And we'll be out in front of Mr. Groden's house and his office. We've been out in front of his office already. He wouldn't come out. And he refused to face us then. He'll probably refuse to face us in the future.
I don't know. If you have your fatigues, Jimmy.
We're going to be out there with fatigues. We'll be in front of his house in Scituate. Father Groden will be out there in Scituate in front of your house. You can either make it easy or you can make it hard. We'll do it either way you want to do it. But it'll get done somehow.
Yeah, and you know, and along what Phil said and kind of the stuff that you're alluding to, I mean, you know, the stuff in the contract, I think that if you're from the West End, it's important not to lose all hope here because an office space, I know right now OWAC has been running largely out of your premises,
right.
And it's been difficult for a formal space and an operation.
Very.
I mean, if these are things we're able to ultimately... be accomplished. I know we're certainly trying to do them. And again, if any plea that I think we're trying to make is prospective counsel here for Old West.
We're running out of time. Any last words, Phil?
Well, if you are an Old West End or you have any concerns in these issues whatsoever, please just don't sit back. Get out there and do what you can. Contact the right people, your representatives and whatnot, and make your voice be heard. You know, the Old West End is building in a great area of Boston, a great city, and here with great tradition. Let's honor this contract, and let's make it as great as it can be.
And if you're not a West Ender, and you care about justice, okay, if you care about justice, and you care about, and you know what happened to West Enders in the old West End, and you know what happened to us just recently, if you care about justice, call up your state legislators, or your federal legislators even, and give us a break. It's time we got a break. We're coming to an end now, and I have to put an end to this. And
can I just say one last thing?
Sure.
One last guy. If by chance, any high-level representatives from Lowell Square Associates were to run into this video, I would make a plea to them that they contact me. I've spoken to their attorneys, and to see if it's possible that the parties can sit down and resolve this very resolvable issue. That's my plea.
Well, I guess that's it. Unless
thank you, Jimmy, for the opportunity.
You're two great guests, and you're two great lawyers, too, by the way. I want to say that. You're from fine firms and everything. And I'll see you at the next West End video newsletter.
Thanks.
Thank you.
Mm-hmm.